We got on stage Peter, and Peter is going to talk to us about pole sets and why they're important. And if you're like me and you don't know what a pole set is, you might find this really interesting. So thank you for this, and then, yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Claudio. Thank you. Thank you for coming. I have to assure you that I also didn't know what pole sets are. So, but actually, why did I get interested in pole sets at all? So my personal reason is we had like this application in production and also a load test. And since years, we were looking at like the log counting results, and they showed the same thing with this log counter tool. So the result looked something like this, that the Erlang VM spent a lot of time waiting for logs, and most of the time was spent waiting for this single log called pole set, this magic name. I didn't know what it is. The other half was spent with these 16 other logs waiting, like driver event state. Again, a strange name. So I wanted to know what it is, how to solve this problem, how to reuse the collision on these logs. My other reason is that, as you might also heard, and I knew it from Kenneth Lundin's talk from last year here at the conference, is that the I/O handling was rewritten completely in the new OTP 21 release. So I tried the same application with the same traffic with OTP 21, and then magic, the pole set lock is gone. So either it was totally removed or there were just no conflicts on it. And this driver event state lock is also, there are much less collision in it. So we can see that there is some improvement. So it is, this pole set lock is related to the I/O handling probably. But first let's see the problem domain, like what is like I/O multiplexing in general, like not in Erlang, but out there in the world. And then I will like recap how was the previous implementation and the new implementation in the Beam. This was already partly covered by Kenneth Lundin. And also we will see two examples, like how this affects some HTTP client libraries and how this affects our complex application, which actually also uses one of the HTTP clients. So the problem itself is, let's say we want to write a server which has a lot of network connections, and it wants to react to incoming data on any of them as fast as possible. So let's assume you want to write a web server in C, so it's not in Erlang. So what can we do? We can like have as many threads as connections, so one thread per connection, and each thread is waiting in a blocking receive, and then it returns immediately if there is data. But the problem with this is that actually like thousands of OS threads, it requires a lot of memory. It also puts pressure on the OS kernel scheduling. So another approach is to have like one thread which basically busy loops over all the connections and calls a non-blocking receive on each of them. And then most of the time it will just return nothing because there is no data. So that's a waste of CPU time. So what can we do instead? And there's the readiness model. So instead of calling a blocking receive or read or other operation, we can do like it in two steps. First, check and wait for the file descriptor to be ready for that operation. For example, ready have data available in it, and then do read the data, and then it is guaranteed that it won't block and will return the data. But this is actually looks the same as a blocking receive. But the good thing is that the operating system supports checking multiple file descriptors at once. So in one call, you don't need multiple threads, you can do it with one call. So this is how like you can multiplex I/O. You can gather all your file descriptors that you want to do some operation on, and then ask the operating system to check these file descriptors and wait for them until some of them gets ready. And so this interest set, so basically this file descriptor that this set of file descriptors, all of them which we are interested in, and plus each of them has like which event type we are interested in. This is called the poll set. And like checking for readiness, basically, this is also called polling. And like check IO is the name of the subsystem that does it within the Erlang virtual machine. So using this polling mechanism, rewriting the web server, it's just one thread. It checks IO on this poll set, which is the connection of all, which is the collection of all the connections, and which we return just a few active connections which are ready. And then we already receive data from those selected few connections. Most of them, none of them, for example, or just, yeah. So that's much more effective. So I also will use and already use like socket and file descriptor interchangeably. Well, that's because like receiving from a socket is the most problematic from my point of view. But in general, the operating system, this polling mechanism supports any kind of file descriptor. So pipes, FIFOs, devices, and other things, except for disk file descriptors, because they don't fit this readiness model. They are not pipes, but random access. So they need to be handled differently. But in OTP, it's mostly network sockets which are polled this way. But if you write your custom port driver or NIF, you can use this driver select and NIF select to actually put any kind of file descriptor into the poll set of the Erlang VM, and then it will notify your driver or NIF about readiness. And then readiness means like ready for reading, ready for writing, is it closed, or is there some error on the file descriptor? So your caller can be notified about various events, actually. It's not just reading. Okay, so now let's see how this is used in the Beam, in the old implementation, so up until OTP 20. So first of all, it's one of the schedulers that does this polling or IO checking at a regular intervals. Either a scheduler does that, which is like idle, so it doesn't have any task in its run queue, or if all the schedulers are busy, then after 4 times 4,000 global reductions, one of them will just stop what it's doing and then check for IO. And the other important thing is that they, when they are interested about some event, they have to update the poll set, and to be thread safe, this needs to be logged. So there is a global lock to protect the poll set, and that's that lock that we've seen that has a lot of conflicts. So that's kind of a scalability issue. So yeah, so there is, as I said, a single global poll set in the Erlang VM. There is a global lock on this poll set to protect it, and it needs to be taken when there is an update. And so when is an update? When you like open or close a socket, you have to add or remove that file descriptor to the poll set. But more often when you like send or receive to that socket, you also have to add your interest to the poll set. And also, for example, when you change the active passive mode of the socket, you have to add or remove the read flag from the file descriptor in the poll set. And I will explain that later why this is important. There's another important thing that actually operating systems support a whole different implementations of polling. So it's actually quite a challenge that the OTP team solving supporting like many of them. So, but there are basically two types, the user space polling and the kernel space polling. There's even a runtime switch to enable kernel polling, but it's off by default. So when it's off, it means that it will use a polling mechanism where the OS kernel is stateless. So the whole poll set, the whole list of file descriptors is stored by the application. And each time it calls the poll, it has to be passed to the kernel. And then the kernel has to go through all the file descriptors and process it and stuff like that. Whereas in kernel space polling, the OS kernel basically stores this poll set, and the application only has to send updates, so only send a diff. So that means, of course, much less work for the kernel. So this sounds like beneficial. So, but still, the default used to be like false until OTP 20. So let's see the new implementation. What's the difference? So now IO checking happens in a dedicated polling thread, so not in the schedulers. And that polling thread only does this, so it's not interleaved with executing Erlang code or anything like that. So it basically can react to events immediately. There can be actually multiple poll threads. And if possible, the Erlang VM will actually update the poll set within the kernel. And the kernel supports basically lockless updates, so it handles somehow the concurrency with magic. But that means the good news is that the poll set lock is removed, as we've seen also from the lock counting. So that improves the scalability a lot. Also, the kernel polling is changed, so to say. So the current, the new implementation prefers to use kernel polling if the OS supports it, and most modern OS is supported. Or it can be actually disabled if you really want to, but most of the cases you don't need to. And this has two good impacts, like the kernel poll implementations. As I said, they support concurrent update directly in the kernel without a lock by multiple scheduling threads, so no poll set lock, no contention. And the other good thing is that it also supports concurrent waiters. So there could be like multiple polling threads waiting for the same poll set. And that's useful when you have a lot of events. So because one, this poll operation can return only 522 events at once. So if there are more than that events, so one polling thread receives notification about 500 events, then it tries to process them, and then meanwhile the other thread waiting for the same poll set receives the next 500 events and can process them. So that adds like some parallelity, so that helps in when there are a lot of events coming in. And also when there is no OS support for kernel space polling, still the polling is done by the separate polling threads, but then there is no concurrent waiters feature, so there must be as many poll sets as poll threads. But there is still no poll set lock, and the updates are actually enqueued in like an update queue, and then the polling threads update that update queue, so it's also like a less lock contended solution, so to say. And then, so the by runtime you can configure when you start the Erlang VM like how many poll sets and poll sets you want. By default it's one, and it should be good enough until several thousands or of connections and several thousands of incoming requests. But if you really have such a big traffic, you can, as I said, increase the number of poll threads to 1024. Well, I think that's pretty future-proof. You won't need like more than two threads, I guess, up until pretty high load. And if you see that the kernel implementation of this concurrent update is somehow not that good, so it has contention, then you can also like split up your poll set into like multiple poll sets. So the file descriptors will be like hashed into like different poll sets. And then hopefully that improves the problem of the OS kernel, but that should not happen. Like most modern OSs implement this pretty well. And of course the runtime, like enabling kernel poll flag, is removed because it's on by default and you can only disable it when you compile the Erlang VM. So getting back to this active-passive mode, as it was kind of important for us. So let's see how different HTTP client libraries are implemented. So for Hackney and iBrowse, they use active once, and this is the most common way. So basically you receive like one message about an incoming request, and then you like stop wanting to receive more until you enable receiving again. So you have flow control, but also you receive the incoming data by Erlang messages, so you don't have a selective receive. So that means like one polset update or a pair of polset updates per response. On the other hand, Buoy, or which is based on Shackle, it uses active true. That means that the socket is always enabled to send messages, always enabled for read. So there is no need to update the polset. It is on all the time. So it's super fast, so I should say, but for the price that there is no flow control. So if someone starts to send in a lot of messages, then the Erlang VM will run out of memory. So that's kind of a big price to pay actually, and only applicable in special situations. Well, actually the predecessor of Buoy, DLHTTPC, and the fork that we are using, so we are unfortunate to use this library. So how this has a kind of complicated model. So when the connection is in the pool and it is unused, it is in active one state, so that it receives a notification if the socket is closed and it can reconnect immediately. But then when the socket is checked out to a worker to send some request responses, then it is switched to active false. So this switch means an update to the poll set. Then it calls receive to receive the HTTP headers and the body, that also an update to the poll set or a few updates. And then when it's ready, then it checks in the socket again to the pool. That's an active once update, one more update to the POSET. So all in all, to send the request response, it's a minimum of 3-4 updates or even more. So that means a lot of locks need to be taken on that single global POSET lock. So I found on the internet a benchmark of HTTP clients by Louis-Philippe Gauthier. His aim was to test like these libraries with different pool sizes and concurrencies, but I'm more interested in comparing the library to itself running on both OTP 19 and 21. So of course, in the comparison, Buoy performed much better, but this is kind of expected also, even from the author of the library who ran the test. So Hackney, it saw a bit of improvement using active ones. Eyebrows, it saw also a bit of improvement. By the way, the x-axis is just test cases, so it doesn't mean anything, and the y-axis is basically the throughput request per second. As we can see, it doesn't scale very well when in the end of the test cases, it's kind of like bigger pool size and bigger clients. But that's not the important. The important is, for example, HTTPC. I think it performs a bit worse on OTP 21, but maybe it's just my test case. Oh, sorry. And then Buoy, it performs pretty well, but it sees no improvement in 21. But this is also expected because it didn't use this poll set lock. And the DLHTPC, finally, it saw a big improvement, like almost like 50% improvement in some of the test cases. Of course, because it used to take a lot of poll set locks, had a lot of contention, and now it's removed. So that was pretty useful. So now let's see how our total application performed. Also, I would like to use this to how we can inspect actually the performance of this I/O handling framework. So the poll set lock is gone, so we cannot use lock counting anymore. But there is microstate accounting. This is another tool. It is similar. Well, it is an improved version of checking scheduler utilization. So instead of just checking the sleep, no sleep time, the no sleep time is also split into several predefined states, one of them being check IO. And it also does not only work for the schedulers, but also other managed threads like dirty schedulers, the async thread pool, the aux thread, and also, which is most important for us, the poll thread. So I run two tests with two nodes, one OTP 19 and OTP 21. This was like with normal load, something like 14,000 outgoing requests per second and using 1,400 TCP connections. And the other test is like extra load, when one of the nodes, the OTP 19 node, was actually fully utilized, so scheduler utilization 100%. That was with about 19,000 requests, but the same number of connections. So this is like a stripped down version of the output of the microstate accounting tool. I removed the threads which were like not used at all, and also removed some columns where the where there was no difference between the new and old Erlang version. So we can see first like the sleep time is 6% and 6% the busy weight on the old node, whereas the new node has like a bit more sleep time and much more busy weight. That means that it does less work and have more time to not do anything. But more importantly, we can see like how much time the polling thread spends in check IO. So it's only about 5% of utilization. So it's nothing. Basically, this 14,000 requests per second, this single poll thread can handle it easily. If it goes near 100% or goes toward that, then you can start to think about like starting multiple poll threads to ease the load on the polling thread. But I couldn't create an artificial test case for that. I couldn't reach that load. And then finally, some strange thing is that like the port microstate, it takes like 15% on the old Erlang and only 4% of the new. So I guess this is also related to the IO improvement. So the INET driver has less work to do. And with the extra load, we can see that in OTP 19, sleep time is zero, busy weight is zero, so it's fully utilized, it's struggling to cope with the work. Whereas in OTP 21, there is still some 1 or 2% of sleep time and busy weight, so it still has some spare capacity. Again, looking at the check IO percentage is 6.6%. So even while the OTP 19 node was like struggling, the OTP 21 node has a lot more capacity for in external IO handling. And again, the port task get even worse in OTP 29. So like more than 20% of the time is spent there, whereas in OTP 21 it's still like 5%. So pretty good. Yeah, here just some latency graphs. On the left side, you can see the OTP 19 latencies, and on the 21 latency. With normal load, there is a bit of improvement. With extra load, there is considerable improvement. So that's basically just for me, that's the positive outcome. So all I care is the latency. I don't mind how much percent the scheduler spends on certain tasks. But we can see that there is a drastic improvement with 21. So to sum up, when does it matter that IO handling was improved in OTP 21? So if your application has like a lot of network connections, especially long-running ones, and or a lot of like busy traffic, network traffic, and maybe many cores, so that the concurrency also matters, then you can expect like improved latency and improved parallel scalability. On the other hand, if you have a lot of like file operation, well, this part of the improvement, like the IO handling framework, it doesn't affect file operations, or shouldn't affect like message passing or like Erlang heavy applications. So finally, I just put here the link to the slides from Kenneth Lundin from last year, and also a post by Lukas Larsson on the Erlang blog post about IO polling, that they are worth to check if you haven't done yet. And thank you.